Grace, mercy, and peace to you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Remind us, O Lord, that in the salutary gift of the Lord's Supper, we enter into the Sabbath that you give to us, providing us rest from the burdens of sin, evil, and death that beset us each day. Amen. You may be seated. Going to divide the message up into two parts. So we're going to cover the actual text itself first, so you get a feel for the illustrations that I'm going to tell you about after we get into the text. So if you want to read or look at the text that Reverend Weldon just read, you may do so. Jesus is talking to a crowd of people. He has sent the disciples off on their first missionary journey, so he's kind of on his own right now. And this is a mixed group of people. It could be Pharisees, Sadducees, regular folks, poor, wealthy, whole bunch of folks. He's giving them some basic instructions, and he knows what they need because Jesus has compassion on the crowds. He always has compassion on the crowds because he knows their need. So he begins. Oh, two things, and you've heard this from me before, but the two things that the people who came to Jesus wanted to know: who are you? What's your identity? What's your authority? He addresses this immediately in the first couple verses. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Did you hear that? Jesus is the Son of the Father. That's his identity. And being the Son of the Father knowing him and Jesus knowing the Father, that is his authority. Like it or not, that's what he is telling the people. The Pharisees are having a cow because they don't want to hear that. The other people are probably saying, yip, yip, hooray, it's about time the Messiah showed up. We've been waiting for 400 years for the promise of the Messiah. He's finally here. Now, what's he going to do? Jesus gets right to it. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So he invites them to come to him. He invites them to take his yoke upon them. And he then says, learn from me what all this means. Learn how it is that I can provide you with relief from your burdens. And you give those to me in exchange for the freedom that I will give you. Freedom forever. And then to connect this, he goes into another passage that addresses something near and dear to our hearts, the Sabbath day. At that time, Jesus went through the grain fields on the Sabbath. His disciples were hungry, and they began to pluck heads of grain and to eat. But when the Pharisees saw it, they said to him, look, your disciples are doing what is not lawful to do on the Sabbath. What was that? They were working. The Pharisees said, by plucking the heads of grain off of the stalk of the wheat or the barley or whatever it was, they were reaping. Come on. But that's what they said. That's what they accused them of. It's kind of the same today, isn't it? Whatever you say can and will be held against you in the court of public opinion. Yeah? Now, he said to them, have you not read what David did when he was hungry and those who were with him, how he entered the house of God and ate the bread of the presence, which it was not lawful for him to eat, nor for those who were with them, but only for the priests. Three things here. Remember in the first one, taking the burdens away from us, come, take, learn. Now he's saying first he compares himself to King David. King David was not violating the law. He was the king, right? David could do what he wanted to do because he had the best interests of the nation at heart. Then he goes into the aspect of the priests. First the king, now the priests. Or have you not read in the law how on the Sabbath the priests in the temple profane the Sabbath and are guiltless? I tell you something greater than the temple is here. So now he compares the priests to the illegality of doing things unlawful in the temple. Finally, and if you had known what this means, I desire mercy and not sacrifice, you would not have condemned the guiltless. Now who's he talking about? That is a quotation from the prophet Hosea. So Jesus is comparing himself as he gets into the last line. If you had known what this means, I desire mercy and not sacrifice, you would have not condemned the guiltless, for the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath. The Son of Man, Lord of the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is greater than King David, he is greater than the priests in the temple, and he is greater than the prophets who predicted this day would come, that the Messiah would appear and do all things necessary to bring the nation back into prominence, and probably in those people's minds, a little aside, save people from their sins. How ironic. Because as we know from our learning in the Bible and from teaching, that Jesus is the king. He is the priest. He is the prophet. All rolled up into one package as both the Son of Man and the Son of God. So he is educating the crowd about himself. Identity and authority. He is Lord of the Sabbath. All right, now you know the text. So let's get into a couple of illustrations of the text so you will leave here knowing somewhat what it can mean for you, not necessarily for you as bona fide believers in Christ, but for those who you will encounter in the world today, especially during the season of Lent, who may still be thinking about Jesus, but not knowing really who he is or what he's about, not knowing his identity or his authority over your life. So if we look at the first part of the text at the end of chapter 11, Jesus has identified himself. He's telling everybody who he is, and that should satisfy their curiosity, or that should bring them to a belief in him as God's son, okay? So then he offers them something. He talks about a yoke. Now, in the days of those times, a yoke would have commonly been seen perhaps as something that would have bound a couple of beasts of burden together, like a couple of oxen, and you would have this bar that would fit across their necks so that they could walk in tandem with each other and do the work basically of two as one. So whatever load they were carrying, it would be easier for them to do it together. Sometimes I think we maybe miss the point on what the yoke means, and I'm going to give you another picture of more or less of a human yoke. And these are very common today. Any third world country you go to, you can see these kind of yokes. These are human yokes, okay? A bar across your back. And on either end, there would be perhaps a rope attached that would have a bucket or basket or something, all right? You go to Africa or India or South America, you will see these kind. In fact, there's an Amish guy here. So the Amish use these things too. Why? Because it's easier to carry the load using this than to carry it in your arms, okay? Because your arms are going to get tired, right? So So this is the kind of yoke that I think Jesus is really talking about here. A yoke that allows us to be relieved of excessive burdens that are part and parcel of our lives. So with this kind of yoke in mind and this kind of relief, that's where I think Jesus wants the people and us today to understand that he has come to take the burdens, the yoke of our sin from us. Now we, in our America and other civilized countries, we've come up with a more modern type of yoke. I'm wearing it, a backpack. Now this backpack today represents the sins I've committed since Sunday. So it's getting a little heavy. But imagine if you had to wear this all day, and if it just kept getting heavier and heavier and heavier, what are you going to do with that? I asked the four-year-olds today, what would you do with this thing? How would you sleep with this thing on your back? You wear it 24 hours a day. Ladies and gentlemen, that is sin. That is sin that is burdening us. That is sin that is causing our spirits to wilt in the midst of the things that afflict us, our sufferings, and our disappointments, and our illnesses, and the things that we should have done and didn't, and the things that we did do and we shouldn't have done, and the things that we should have said, and the love that we should have expressed, but for whatever reason, we didn't. This is what Jesus is talking about. So let me give you a very clear illustration of how this can affect someone's life. Anyone recognize the name Carla Faye Tucker? Carla Faye Tucker was a young woman who was executed by the state of Texas on February 3rd, 1998. She was the first woman in 135 years to be executed by the state of Texas. Why was she executed? She killed two people. She was tried, convicted, and sentenced to the death penalty. She spent 14 years on death row, waiting for her execution. While she was in jail, during her trial, someone gave her a Bible. She began to read God's word. She became convicted of her sins, and they were many. She started out at the ripe old age of 14 as a prostitute, and went from there into drugs and alcohol, and following rock and roll bands around as a groupie and a failed marriage, and then into theft to keep the drug habits going, which resulted in a double murder. Knowing from reading God's word that she had done these terrible things and was being condemned for them, her sin nature blossomed, but in the midst of the gospel, knowing what Jesus has come to do for her, she gave her life, her heart, her soul to Jesus Christ. She became not only a model prisoner when she was sent to live in Gatesville, Texas for most of her life on death row. She became a dedicated Christian. Reverend Tim Carter served in the Texas penal system for many years, and he happened to be on what was called the Death Squad, which was a group of guards who were specially assigned on the day of an execution to shepherd in the witnesses and the families and to take care of the one who was to be executed. He had not met her until the day of her execution. He met her, he knew of her reputation, he knew of the outcry. They were having protests all day long because the Christian community knew she was a Christian. She was everywhere in the media. Even Pope John Paul II asked for clemency and mercy, but none was granted. So this is what Tim saw as he observed her on this day that she was going to die. Watching this condemned inmate console, comfort, and minister to her keepers was completely amazing to me. If anyone in that death house had a reason to be crying, it was the inmate herself. But Carla was genuinely concerned for the well-being of others and was very effectively ministering to them. Carla never wanted any pity or sympathy, nor did she want the attention for herself. Rather, she was attentive never to miss an opportunity to bless any employee or visitor with encouraging words of appreciation, and to compliment them. Carla's prayer time that day was spent praying for others, not for herself. That is a person who had given up her yoke of sin and handed it off to Jesus. And in exchange, Jesus handed her the freedom, the knowledge, the understanding that I, Jesus, have taken your sins upon myself, and I have given you the assurance of forgiveness of sins and everlasting life. And Carla spent the rest of her life responding to that great gift, that wonderful freedom that only Jesus can give to us who accept his invitation, come, take, and learn from me, because my burden is light, and I will give it to you. I will call you to me and invite you to accept it. And if you do, this is what your life can be like. Carla, in an interview, shortly, maybe a couple weeks before she was executed, had this to say: circumstances do not dictate our joy. We have to get through our wilderness to find ourselves able to minister to others in their wilderness. He, Jesus, has to take us out of our comfort zone so we can become effective ministers. It's not a matter of just getting over it, but trusting that he will walk through life's tribulations along with us. This is a revelation of his will for us, putting us through challenges so we are equipped to love others in their pain. Let God be God. We cannot dictate how God is to be God for us. Inner healing comes from releasing our life to God, giving our body and spirit over to him. The second part of the scripture for tonight involves the Sabbath. And I learned something in preparation for the message tonight. Reverend Weldon and I are using a Lenten series published by Concordia, and the author gives us some insights into the various scripture passages that we decide to preach on. And in the one for tonight, he informed me of something that I had not realized before. That if you look at the life of Jesus, it parallels creation. Yeah. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, day one through day six. And on the seventh day, what did God do? He rested. How about Jesus? When did Jesus enter Jerusalem? Palm Sunday. 5 days, Monday through Friday. Jesus was in the area, ministering, teaching, preaching, preparing himself and his disciples for what was to come. On Friday evening, he died. 6 days. He went into the grave, the Sabbath day. He rested. Jesus rested in the grave on the Sabbath day for us, so that he could rise on Sunday and show us the way to heaven. It's an amazing thing to think about. Jesus not only is Lord of the Sabbath, he is the Sabbath. We come here on what we call Sunday, or perhaps the Sabbath. In the Jewish time, the Sabbath was on Saturday. The Christians moved it to Sunday because of the resurrection of Christ. The day doesn't matter. The time doesn't matter. What matters is it's him. It's him that we come here to meet. It's him that speaks to us through the words that ministers give to you, through words that the Bible gives to you, through words that the hymn writers give to all of us. And in that, we find ourselves in a situation that is beyond our understanding, but in a situation where Christ has joined with us, he being the Sabbath, he has come as our Sabbath to give us rest from our burdens. So that when we come here and you see it, take eat, take, drink. When we do that, we receive Him. We receive His real presence. We see that small light coming down from the cross to show us what the foretaste of the feast to come is. Our yokes can be left at the altar. Our burdens can be removed on the day that we have the Lord's Supper. Place it here, the foot of the cross. That's what He's asked us to do. Because in Him, our Sabbath rest, He frees us from the burdens of our sin. He provides for us rest for the weary. As children of God, a little slow tonight. Now may the peace of God that surpasses understanding guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.